what I will be talking today would be kind of part two of David's presentation on Murray Rothbard and other scholars of the von Mises Institute. During the last 30 years, von Mises Institute developed a very impressive body of knowledge on political economy of war. And so we have the works of Murray Rothbard, of Ralph Raico, of Robert Higgs, which I think that it's kind of establishes the revisionist school, Austrian school of history, of political economy, of these sad developments. And definitely we are trying to complement each other. As Soviet dictator Leonid Brezhnev once said that about Politburo members, that they developed an atmosphere of uncritical mutual adoration, which is appropriate only for capitalist society. So the alternative, the socialists, usually would behave like spiders in a jar. So I would say that in von Mises Institute, which is the most pro-capitalist institution, research institution in the world, I think that it is very nice that we do peacefully cooperate with each other and like each other work. Well, today I will talk about this gang of four. This is a picture actually which was posted near the Vilnius airport in Free Lithuania. And so that's the Ludwig von Mises, he wrote that the characteristic feature of this age, and he was writing that exactly in 1934, is the age of the destructive wars and social disintegration, is the revolt against economics, And that's exactly what happened. Von Mises wrote in Human Action that there are two patterns of socialism. And these two patterns would be, one is Russian pattern, and another would be German pattern of socialism. And Russian pattern would be purely bureaucratic, when everything is owned by the state. So the whole economy is run like a huge post office, So, that's a Russian pattern. And then there is a German pattern, which nominally preserves private ownership of markets, prices, wages, and interest rates. They are, however, no longer entrepreneurs, but only shop managers, Betriebsführer in the terminology of the Nazi legislation. So amazingly enough that usually we would think that, say, the Western countries, the so-called Western democracies, would follow German pattern. And I remember that Murray Rothbard would talk about that we are not yet on the Russian path. We are mostly following this German pattern of socialism. However, if you will look back, you would see that Russian pattern is also very much around, with the government motors, with the government owning a lot of our economy, and nationalization of healthcare industry, which is about 24% of our gross domestic product. So it's almost one fourth of our economy. If we will put healthcare, pharmaceuticals, industry of medical devices together, so that's quite a lot. Amazingly enough, that between the wars, which was this period of self-destruction of capitalism. even propaganda, even posters were very similar, very similar. This is one of the Roosevelt's posters, that work promotes confidence. In Soviet Union, the poster would look exactly the same with the same person even, and that would say, work is honor. And you remember what in Hitler's concentration camps they had, Arbeit macht frei. So the work makes you free. So this is the this even thinking about that is more or less the same. This also, if you will replace capital with Kremlin, that would look like a typical Soviet poster about security, about social security. The government will take care of you. And Murray Rothbard, he did a lot of work to expose this tide of zeitgeist, the spirit of time. The 20th century was for him a century of evil that had to be repudiated. Rothbard believed that history is not progressive. It doesn't all the time go only up and up and up. History is erratic. And the most tragic kind of dip it took in the 20th century, the most bloodiest century in the history of human earth. Rudy Rummel, a demographer from University of Hawaii, he wrote 28 books about that. One is famous book, Death by Government, in which he believes that over 200 million people were murdered by socialists of all kinds during the 20th century. That's more than at any other century in the history of human society. And well, talking about Stalin, who was definitely the most evil out of the four, he created the real perfect killer state, And in Soviet Union alone, they murdered anywhere from 43 to 61 million people. I was, last Thursday, I was, just 2 days ago, was at Montclair State University in New Jersey. And we had debate, and I presented libertarian point of view against conservative and against so-called liberal. And the so-called liberal was not a liberal even. He was the most ardent Stalinist fanatic that I ever met. I never met people like him, even in Soviet Union or Communist China, to that matter. And his name is Grover Fur. If you would have time, just look him up on the internet. Grover Fur, F-U-R-R. David Horowitz, who is kind of neoconservative, specialist in education, he believes that he is the worst professor in the world. And he is teaching since 1917 that poor university, exposed to this view. He believes that Stalin didn't kill enough. Yeah, that Stalin didn't kill enough. That the worst thing, and so all of these unkilled people, then they badmouthed him after he died. And so that's it was very difficult to even to talk about that. Yes, for example, we discussed also war on drugs. He said all drugs in the world are produced by the CIA, and so we need just to abolish CIA, which I agree with. And then the drug problem would disappear. I don't think CIA is capable of anything like that. So Murray wrote also that private property under the regimes of this gang of four is eliminated. Individualism goes by the board. Individuality is flattened. All property is owned and controlled communally, and the individual units of the new collective organism are in some vague we equal to one another. If I would be like Mr. Fur, if I would be a present tenant of the White House, I would do exactly that the program is right here. And I think that exactly what is happening today. So Rothbard, he focused, I think, his attention on the fact that there is not much, it's only quantitative, not qualitative difference between welfare state and socialism. That both patterns, that the German pattern and the Russian pattern, are essentially complementary to each other. That when you go on the slippery slope, then you would end up, by the logic of history, you would be drawn into gulags, into Stalinism, into mass murder. And other members of the Gang of Four, they were trying to do that. Some of them succeeded more than others. But we will just talk a little bit about that. Well, this is a little bit premature. I hope that that all of our socialist idols would end up like that. So there, a great analysis of the war and Great Depression, which led to socialization in the United States, for us to lose freedoms, was associated with Franklin Delano Roosevelt and his New Deal. It's analyzed in the great book Depression, War, and Cold War Studies in Political Economy. I think that the works of Bob Higgs are already classical works of our time. Well, we'll return back to that. Ralph Raker, Great Wars and Great Leaders, a Libertarian Rebuttal, another great work published by von Mises Institute. Also, Ralph Raker published a lot of wonderful articles about Churchill on LouRockwell.com, on von Mises' site as well. So let's look at them a little bit more attentively. Who were these people and how did they interact with each other? Well, Churchill, this is a quote from Ralph, that Churchill was a racist goes without saying, yet his racism went deeper than with most of his contemporaries. It is curious how with his stark Darwinian outlook, his elevation of war to the central place in human history and his racism, as well as his fixation on great leaders, Churchill's worldview resembled that of his antagonist, Hitler. And this is absolutely true, because if you will look, that was Hitler and to some extent Stalin. Well, Stalin won the Second World War. I mean, that if you would look who won the Second World War, that was Stalin. The Second World War was officially the war for independence and freedom of Poland. So Poland was sacrificed first after the war. It was given to Stalin on a plate with a silver lining. And about 800,000 Poles were murdered just in a short period of time between 1946 and 1949, when Bolesław Bierut established his communist dictatorship in Poland. Churchill adored Stalin. It's amazing that Churchill had this fascinatingly, I would say, idiotic idea that Stalin did not represent ideology, that Stalin was not a socialist, that Stalin was fighting for Russian national interests, that Stalin was Russian nationalist in disguise of Georgian communist, which sounds bizarre, because in Russian national interest, if such thing exists, I think it doesn't, what means national interest, but in interest of all Russians would be to get rid of Stalin right away, because he destroyed Russian people more than anybody else in Russian history. Churchill used to say, one may dislike Hitler's system and yet admire his patriotic achievement. If our country were defeated, I hope we should find a champion as admirable to restore our courage and lead us back to our place among the nations. This is a quote from Winston Spencer Leonard Churchill. So this, and he talked about that in 1937. He published an article in The Guardian. You can see that he admired Hitler, also as a nationalist, admired Hitler, that Hitler is pursuing German national interest. he, at that time, also, that was already in 1939, he said at the meeting of the British cabinet that I cannot forecast to you the action of Russia. It is a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. But perhaps there is a key. That key is Russian national interest. So he, before the war, Churchill embraced both dictators, Hitler and Stalin alike, as promoters of their national interests, of which Churchill himself was envious. In the first quote, you can see that he probably would be that champion admirable enough to restore, to restore our courage. So, speaking about his humanism, because he was presented as a humanist, he got a Nobel Prize for literature. At that time, I think Nobel Prize committee had enough decency not to offer him a Nobel Prize for peace, because because if there will be a Nobel Prize to the worst warmonger, then he could compete for that definitely. Because Churchill, there was not a war that Churchill didn't like. And Churchill personally participated in all wars which happened during his lifetime. In all wars, he was either a war correspondent or an officer or a planner or a person who is responsible for mass murder of his own people. He was first Lord of Admiralty in 1917 during the Gallipoli disaster, during which, and he should take all responsibility, and he, and many historians do blame him for engineering of this mass butchery of mostly British, New Zealand, and Australian soldiers in Turkey. So, then these three adored each other, especially Roosevelt. He loved Stalin. His ambassador in Moscow, Davis, was writing to Roosevelt in 1938 that he is impressed by the courage with which Stalin is getting rid of trash. And trash would be that people, that all the staged trials, all the staged show trials, Davis believed that all of them were true. All of these people confessed. All of these people confessed. Now we have, I'm working at the Library of Congress at the Volkogon of Archives. This is amazing archives. Soviet General Volkogonov, he was a Soviet propaganda hitman. And I would switch him off right away. He was just even, I don't know, worse than Rachel Maddow or whomever else. And I didn't know that since 1980, he was making highly illegal copies of secret Soviet documents. He was a director of the Soviet Institute for Military History. And then when Soviet Union collapsed, he shipped them all to the Library of Congress. U.S. government insisted to ship them to the CIA, and he resisted that. Yeah, because CIA would put it on lead again. That's for sure. So in the Library of Congress, we have this fascinating handwritten memos by all of these people. And from this Volkogon of archives, it is obvious that, for example, these other two, Churchill and Roosevelt, they would send telegrams to each other all the time. There was no internet. And so they were sending telegrams. And these telegrams would be read by Stalin earlier than they would be reach the White House or the Downing Street 10. So so Stalin was monitoring all correspondence between this other two, between this other two. The major kind of, I would say, betrayal of Europe was at Yalta. In Yalta, they agreed that there'll be free elections in the countries of Eastern Europe, that government of Poland will be both communist and non-communist. I don't know how that would come. And they agreed also to set up the United Nations, So this is, from all points of view, this is absolutely ridiculous. What really happened was, as you know, that Stalin got most of Europe, everything he wanted. And these people were doomed for the communist slavery for a long time. Then the outcome of this, and I see that my time is running out. Well, Soviets, ex-Soviets even experienced shortage of everything. And even my books already are gone and everything, yeah. Oh, speaking about books, before I'll forget, I just published this book. It's called Tea Party and the American Counter-Revolution. It will be reprinted because this is pretty bad edition, and you can see how awfully it is. It's written together with Roman Skaski, a great libertarian who is a great friend of the Mises Institute as well. And And so we have welfare state. What if I will just go to what do we face today? And this is what we do. And that's what this the Roosevelt and Churchill created in the West. And I'm so sorry, I just didn't. some people would say that well, the guy is very good. Well, Stalin was very good in 1915. You can see that. And I would like to end with this, that all collectivist social utopias will end in a disaster, irrespective of difference in detail. That Murray's Rothbard dictum, I think we see it unravel. We see this welfare states unraveling before our eyes, the same way as the Soviet Empire unraveled. However, everybody thought that it will exist for another 10,000 years. Well, thank you very much. It looks like my time is gone, but I will be around this weekend because I definitely have way more to say.